You're watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. Follow along with projects and footage with a premium download available at BorisFX.com. Hello and welcome back to the final section of our overlook of the stabilized module. And in this part, we are looking at this shot here and seeing how we can work with some of the different ways of stabilizing up and art directing our stabilization and some different methods of dealing with the black bars that we get around our image when we have stabilized it. So first and foremost, we need to get tracking data, because without tracking data, we can't do anything. And I want to track this hut. So I'm going to start where we can see the hut the most, something around about there. And let's create up our first shape. So let's bring this around here. I'm not going to get too granular with the shape, but I just want to get a general overview of what it's doing. But I am a little bit concerned how this metal thing is going to affect our track. Now, I could do a track mat as we've done in previous exercises, or I could just make sure that our shape doesn't get affected and touched by this as it goes through. And I think this style, let's come into our view controls, turn that on. And I think this shape with the cutout here and not taking in the bottom plank here is going to be just fine. So let's call this one hut track. I am going to track in everything, including perspective. Flat, immobile shape, we should be pretty good tracking in perspective, even though we have some non-coplanar things. I think the overall shape itself is going to track in just fine. Like these posts that are sticking out, these would have the ability to mess up our tracking data if we wanted to get like 100% perfect insert going on. But for the purposes of tracking, I think this is going to be just fine. And as I hoped, it didn't touch the metal area there. All right, so let's come in. Let's right click and turn on our parameters. Could also go down to view parameters or just change the workspace. As we saw when we were doing the rotoscoping, I could actually save my current workspace as Ben Stabilize. Okay, so let's have a little look what happens when we go into stabilize and stabilize out everything. I'm going to turn off my color overlays and I'm going to turn off my shape overlays as well. And we have a nice stabilized shot of the hut. It looks fine. You know, if this is what we wanted, that's great. We can sort of paint this up and do things. We've got that dolly zoom effect that we saw when we were looking in, I think it's exercise 5 of the right way of using tracking data. So that's kind of interesting, but this is not what we're after. Let's turn off maximum smoothing. So now we've got the overall movement going still of pushing in towards the hut, but we've taken out a lot of the main sort of shake. Problem is, this has left us with a lot of black around. So what this means is that in trying to stabilize things out, we've got a lot of blank area that's not filled in anymore. Now there's another thing that we can do to kind of art direct how this stabilization works, and that's using our fixed frame list. You'll notice that when we stabilized out, it stabilized around frame 0, like the first frame, I should say. This could be frame anything, but the first frame. If instead I wanted it to, be stabilized around somewhere in the middle of the shot, we can use our frame list to do that. So all I do is move my cursor to where I want it to stabilize around and hit plus at the bottom of the frame list, and that will bring that in there. Now if I play this through, it's still doing the same stabilization work, but we have our sort of main center point, so to speak, set in our frame list. So this is one way where we can decide how Mocha works with the stabilization. There's something else we can do as well though. I'm going to just go to 210 again and just delete that from the frame list. I could also just have it selected and just delete like that. So clear that completely. Because one of the most common ways of working with a frame list is to set 2 points for it. If I set one frame at the start, go to the end and set another frame at the end, we've now locked in this end frame as well. We have our lock at the start and we have our lock in the middle. So if I play this through now, we can see we get a little bit more of our natural motion back. And that's because the way that Mocha's compensating is this. We are doing the stabilization, plus we are adding on top of that linear frames. So to get those frames being full frames where the image is right in the middle. And this is a really powerful way of limiting how much extra work you have to do afterwards to try to sort of fill in the missing gaps. So as we play it through now, we don't have as big sort of black borders as we had previously. That's because, you know, we're not going as extreme to stabilize things out. And this gives us a really nice combination between a natural movement and a more stabilized shot. And it doesn't have to be just two frames either. I can come in, let's go somewhere where we're drifting quite far again, probably around about here, add another frame to the frame list, and this locks this frame in as well. So we do want to be a bit careful of not adding too many frames into the list. I'll clear this list out because I'll show you how this looks when we're not dealing with time code, when we're actually dealing with frame numbers. That might be a bit easier to see. And in After Effects, I'm just going to come to my display style at the top left-hand corner of the timeline and hit Control and just turn me into frame numbers instead. Great. So let's come back into Mocha. And we're now looking at frame numbers rather than time code. So I'll pop into my stabilized workspace that I made a second ago. And let's add in some more frames. So I'll add one at the start, which is frame 0. One at the end, frame 131. Zoom out a second, and one somewhere in the middle here-ish. There we go, frame 86. We need to be quite careful about not adding too many frames into this frame list or not adding these into the wrong place, because it can start making that stabilization look less realistic and more mechanical. And I'll show you an example of that. If I just delete the end keyframe, so the 131, so we take it in, so this is looking kind of nice and natural up to frame 86, which is around about here. And then all of a sudden, because we're not doing any more compensation, we get a little bit of a jump as it starts to only use the stabilization data. With this actual movement, it's not, you know, it's not too egregious. It's not too horrible. So generally speaking, I'd set my frame list to the start frame and somewhere near the end, usually actually at the end. If absolutely necessary, could stick one in the middle, but because they're linear keyframes, you might see it a little bit more obviously than if you're just at the beginning and the end. So this gives us still the problem of like the black areas where we don't have any pixels anymore, there we go, because we've stabilized those out. So what do we do with those? Well, this is where we come into this area over on the right-hand side. And I'm going to go into borders first, because this is how we handle the borders. So we can zoom them up. Very nice. We can apply a crop, which you won't see in this view, but you will see once it's rendered in. And we can also like center it as well. So what this does is it kind of repositions everything, so we're losing the sort of smallest amount of data as possible. So it automatically moves our shot, so it's starting in the center, so we're losing as little as possible. And we can combine this with the zoom. So we can see with the center turned on, we're having to zoom in a little bit less. I come over here. We can still see the same sort of thing. There we go. It's kind of cool. And these are the most normal ways of working with it. So the border, filling that in just by scaling it up in a smart way using center and zoom. What we can also do though, is we can also use autofill. If I turn autofill on, we can see hopefully some sort of familiar faces down here. If you've watched Mary's video about the remove module, then you'll know what these are doing. Yeah, so the autofill is using some of the same technology from remove to fill in this data. And you can get, you know, rather detailed with how this is working, which is admittedly a little bit out of the scope of this video. Or you can do things the easy way and just fill from background here. Okay, so now if we play it back, why can't we see anything happening? Now, like with anything that uses that, you know, remove style engine, we actually have to render these frames out. And where do we render? Well, we don't have any render buttons in Essentials mode. So I'm going to come into Classic mode here. And this changes our layout very slightly from how we had it, but it also brought up our render buttons. Of course, we could just right click on these and turn on our render buttons at this stage here, but we're pretty much working in Classic mode anyway now. So, and let's see what happens when I hit render. Well, it has a little look and it fills in those missing details. Now, what you might see, depending on your footage, you might see a little bit of a black border around here. This is a little bit of a render artifact. There's a couple of ways we can get rid of this. One is to try to use the dissolve. If I click and render this, this helps to sort of blend those frames a little bit more. If we're still seeing it, then we have to just do something in the clip tab over here. We haven't really taken a lot of time to look at the clip tab, but it's where we come in and we can sort of look a bit more about what our clip is doing. And I can come in and just crop a few pixels around the edges, maybe crop, you know, 10 pixels around here. Let's pop into stabilize again and re-render that. And just by cropping those pixels, we've actually taken away that black border. It's just something that's happening with the black border there. You might find, if we have a little look, I'll zoom in down there, you might find that it's not able to find all of the information from the frame, so we still end up with a little bit of black. And that's where this search range comes in. So the search range is how many frames back and forth it's looking for. If we think we do have the information somewhere, we can just add, you know, a little bit to our search range. I'll re-render that. And I'll try and fill in those gaps a little bit more. The higher that number, the longer it's going to take to render stuff out because it's having to look through more frames. If we don't have it, we might as well keep this at a lower number anyway. And we get faster renders. When I'm doing anything that needs rendering, I'll just render out a couple of frames just to make sure that things are looking how I want them to. Then I can save and just come back into our host because we don't have to render in Mocha to be able to render it back in the host. In fact, that can actually be slower than just, you know, rendering directly in the host because it doesn't give us anything. So if I come now into my render module, render the stabilize, go here, you can see that's now building up the data from the edges to kind of help to sort of bring that all in. It's not perfect. And if you wanted it a bit more perfect and a bit more accurate, then you can read more about how to set up your own patches for stabilization. So it will just read from those rather than just try to do it automatically. But it's a faster way of trying to fill in those pixels. Although more often than not, I'll just use the center and zoom in the borders because it's faster and generally gives me the results that I need and are, you know, completely usable. So if we come back into Mocha and we see that we have this message happening here, frame blah, 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 not rendered in your clip. you've got a couple of choices. One is to render it in the stabilize, which is fine if you just want to see how the stabilize module would render that out. The other way is to just come up to the top and look at our viewer controls here and change our view from stabilize to the selected layer. So this lets us look back at our original clip again. So if I have my layer selected, I'll turn off autofill. I'll turn on center and zoom. And that's the result that I want to take out of our stabilize module. Great. So in this final part of looking at the stabilize module, we looked at a few different things. As ever, we were very careful and thoughtful about the shape that we wanted to track in and how that was going to be positioned. And then in the stabilize module, we looked at frame lists and how to deal with borders, whether we're going to just scale them up and out or using the autofill to help to reconstruct some of that missing data. Now, there are still more detailed things to learn about the stabilized module, but this should be more than enough for you to start getting going and work with, you know, almost all of your project. In the next exercise, we're going to move on now from the stabilized module and look at one of the other Mocha Pro modules, the lens module, and start to think about how the lens that we've shot with is going to affect our workflow. So let your brain rest a little bit from the stabilized module. And join me again in exercise 18, where we explore the lens module. You've been watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. To download all videos, projects, and footage, purchase the premium version available at BorisFX.com.